All right, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Energy 244, which is Biorenewable Resources. Today being the first day of class, we're going to go over the syllabus, take a look at week one, and kind of give you a feel for how to get around the class. Having a little bit of electronics problems here, so sorry the video is not up, but you know what, I don't think you need to see my ugly mug anyhow. Don't worry about it. Let's jump right into it and take a look at the syllabus, because that's kind of the key document that runs this entire program. So I want you guys to take a close look at this. And again, like I said, we're having some technical difficulties, so excuse the roughness. Again, this is Energy 244. It's Biorenewable Resources, 3 credits. And we're going to talk about biomass primarily and how it compares to other fuels. Where does it come from? How do we produce it? How do we harvest it, refine it, and use it for energy, feedstocks, or whatever it is that we're going to use it for? We're using biorenewable resources, or biomass is what we typically refer to it. What we're actually using is the energy that plants have created through photosynthesis, right? We're actually taking the body of the plant and typically combusting it to get a use, to get heat out of it, typically, is what we're looking for to get our use. So we'll go into all different kinds, kind of the most common feedstocks, so, you know, the stuff that we use the most. Some of it may be burned directly as the biomass, or it may be converted into biodiesel. You know, there may be some other sources other than just direct combustion of the plant matter itself. And we'll go into all those different kinds of opportunities that we have with biomass. So this class does rely pretty heavily on science. So your prerequisites, obviously, your science 175 is a really good start on that. That'll help you understand some of the science that we dig into here. And then, of course, Energy 101 and 102. Covered this, you know, just maybe touched on it, but what's really going to help you is the time you spent with Brad working on crazy equations, because this class is almost entirely word problems and crazy math equations. You'll find that they're actually fairly simple once you get the basics of it, and hopefully you've already got that through Energy 101, 102, so it shouldn't be too much of a struggle. We will make it a point, though, that you do have a practice problem every week, along with your homework assignment, which will be also a some sort of a equation, a word problem, for whatever type of biofuel we happen to be studying that week. It will be some sort of conversion. You know, how many hectares of switchgrass does it take to equal, I don't know, 1 gigajoule of energy? Well, we've got all the tables in the book, and you'll dig through that and you'll figure that out. And basically write up a word problem, do the math, and come up with an answer. By the end of the course, you'll have no problems with word problems. And I guess if you're sick and twisted like me, you might even start enjoying them by the end of it. As far as the textbook goes, textbook is Biorenewable Resources. If I had the camera, I'd hold it up here for you. Engineering New Products from Agriculture. It's by Robert C. Brown. It's a really good book. I find myself using this constantly. You know, even after I took the course, there's a lot of useful tables. There's a lot of useful information on embodied energy in different types of biomass. And I find myself constantly referring back to that to kind of, you know, compare energy sources or fuel sources and see what would be most efficient for that scenario. Really good book anyhow. You can get it at the bookstore, $99.95 for new copies, $75 for used copies. I have not looked at the bookstore today to see whether or not they have any in there. If not, Amazon is always a good deal, as you see right here in the syllabus, under $10, and they usually have it within a week or two. There's one in the library. I didn't check to make sure that was checked, or that was not checked out either, but there should be at least one copy in there. And you know what, if worst case scenario, if all else fails, feel free to swing by my office or Brad's office. We'll let you borrow ours for a little while to crank out your homework. This class is very similar to all the other classes you've taken, but we've got some objectives in there. Understand where basics of energy production, delivery, consumption, and waste disposal. Pretty straightforward, same stuff you've been doing in Energy 101 and 102. We have comprehend traditional, alternative, and sustainable energy production technologies. Again, more continuation of what we've been doing. Evaluate energy production sites. Design, install, maintain, and manage energy systems. Assess societal, economic, environmental, ethical, and legal impacts of energy systems. So we really just want to get to know the inside and out, ins and outs of biofuels in this. It's going to be quite a bit of computer work, obviously. Homework's going to keep you busy. Excel is your friend for a lot of these equations. Excel seems to be a really good way to write out the equations to keep things in order. The biggest thing on any of these equations, though, is don't skip anything. Make sure you include every single step, and that's part of it, of your homework. I don't just want to see a correct answer. Brad doesn't just want to see a correct answer. We actually want to see the equation typed out. It hasn't really changed from any other class. Show me each step of the equation, each one of the conversions. Don't skip any steps, so I can see how you got to your answer. If your problem has 7 or 8 steps, or even 20 steps, you know, as you get deeper into this, there might be that many steps in your equation and your conversions. If you don't show me any work and you just show me a wrong answer, it does me no good. I can't do anything, you know, really for your grade. But if you show me every step of the equation all the way through, and I see that, oh, look at that, on step 2, you know, you screwed up a step here, and that's why your numbers are messed up, but you followed it all the way through and your equation is sound, yeah, I can give you credit for that. That's not a problem. But I need to be able to see all the work. So, like I said, that's actually a really good way to do it, is in Excel, because then I can see everything. Let's see. One of the other things that's going to happen in this is you are going to do a field trip and a term paper on that field trip. You're going to investigate, select, visit, interview, and then report on a biorenewable project of your choosing. As an example, for mine, I went to the Missoula Wastewater Treatment Plant. We took about a 3-hour tour. It was pretty fascinating, a lot of fun. And at the end of it, once I knew all the ins and outs of it, how it worked, then I came back and wrote my term paper on that. There are a couple choices that you can use. That's always a good choice, and available to us. I'd like for you to coordinate so we don't have 5 different students going to Missoula Wastewater Treatment Plant on 5 different days. Let's get it coordinated so you guys all go on the same day, and they only have to give us one tour. And then that kind of helps you guys too, because you guys can compare notes on what you got for answers, and all of you will come up with a better project as a result. Another option is Hall's Dairy. Some students have done that one. You can look at their methane capture and electricity generation using the methane. Is a good option. And then we also have a couple other local businesses around here that you are welcome to research, find those, but then run it by Brad. Make sure Brad approves of it, that it's okay, that it is a suitable topic for your term paper. Once you get the go-ahead, there's no reason for you to not get started on it now, even though it may not be due until later. Go ahead and get started on it now, because it does take some time, obviously, to write a term paper and to get that, get all your data collected. All right, so what we're going to look at, course outcomes, what we want to see is we want that broad comprehension of biorenewable resources, all kinds of different stuff that we have out there, right? There are things that you've probably never even thought of as being biofuels or something that's usable. So we want a good comprehension of that, and the conversion technologies. How do we make it into something useful? Because what we harvest from nature may not be usable in the condition that it is, but we have conversion technologies to be able to make it useful for what we do. Knowledge of the chemical and physical foundations of the biomass industry. We will get into chemistry somewhat. If you struggle with chemistry, don't worry about it. We will help you through that. I think Brian, in his brief on this in week one, talks a little bit about that. That if you take a look at the textbook and you look at chapter two, it gets into some crazy, crazy chemistry. We will not get that crazy into the chemistry. And if you have problems with the chemistry at all, come see Brad, come see me. We'll go see your classmates. We'll help you through it. None of this chemistry is going to be crazy over your head stuff. Believe me, I wouldn't have made it through if it was. So don't stress the chemistry part of it. We'll get you through it. Field experience of a commercial biomass facility. That's what we're talking about with a field trip in your term paper. Environmental assessment of biomass technologies. We look at biomass and we say, oh, it's wonderful, you know, it's zero emissions. We're not doing anything, you know, bad because we're just burning switchgrass, right? Yeah, maybe not. It still has to be used responsibly, but we're going to be able to look at each one of those and see why some are preferable to others and why we choose different kinds of biomass for different desirable traits that they may have. So we're going to be able to take a look at that. And then economic considerations of the biomass industry. One of the exercises I was going to do today, if anybody showed up in class, was, and some of you guys have probably already seen this, my love of word problems. We were going to take a look at coal versus biofuels for producing electricity and how much biomass would be required if we were just to say, you know what, tomorrow we're going to stop burning coal, we're going to use switchgrass instead. We can calculate that, and by the end of this course you'll be able to calculate that, no problem. For the most part you can right now. But looking at the economic considerations of that, you know, the first thought is, well, what about everybody in the coal industry? And that's something that we're looking at right now. Coal strip being shut down with EPA regulations. We're shutting down coal strip 1 and 2 in the next year or two. That's a big deal, and that's thousands of jobs, right? Well, you switch it over to switchgrass. We're going to have people growing switchgrass, right? So farmers are going to have work that will replace that. That's a good thing, right? We look at that, and that's a positive thing. Another economic consideration is the quantity of land mass that would be required to grow enough switchgrass to replace coal would be 2/3 of the United States. And that's assuming every square foot is tillable, growable land. Everything, you know, from like, say, Chicago to the West Coast and north to south borders would be solid switchgrass. Well, there's a lot of farming going on in there. And, you know, the people in San Francisco and the people in Las Vegas and the people in Salt Lake City might not be all that happy that we are bulldozing their city so we can plant switchgrass. So that's some of the things we're going to look at, some of the considerations of it, just like we have with anything else, with wind, solar, nuclear, you name it. There's pluses and there's minuses. We're going to take a look at that. All right, sorry, I just launched my mouse. Okay, bring that the mouse back. So other than the field trip requirement, everything here is web-based. We know everybody can handle computers. You guys have already done a lot of web-based classes. We will have a butts in seat component of it every week at 3 o'clock in Grizz House 9. And you can come hang out with me or Brad, and we will have all kinds of fun and work word problems, and you can get any questions answered that you might have But that being said, you can do this strictly online if that is how you prefer to do it. One thing is though, this class is very intensive. This is not a class to get behind in. There is a homework assignment every single week. There is a quiz every single week, because each week we are going to cover a different biomass technology. So just because we're talking about switchgrass this week doesn't mean we're going to be talking about it next week. It will come up, it may come up in discussion, but we're just going to jump from one fuel to the next. So there is no time to screw around in this class. But with that being said, it's not super intensive. Literally, you can probably do everything that you need to do in this class per week in less than 2 hours. Do your homework, do the sample problem, do the homework problem and submit it, and take your quiz. It's all pretty straightforward stuff that you've seen before. You won't see much change from what's already here. It's not like we're going to be throwing extra assignments in or anything. What you see is what you get. And we'll take a look at the actual Moodle shell here in a few minutes once we get through this. Assignments are due the first week of class. It's just like Brad does, has always done. It needs to be due if this class meets on Thursday at 3 in the afternoon. It has to be in by Thursday at 2:59 for the previous week. If it's after that, it's late. Any email goes only through official UM email addresses. I know it's a pain to log on to there rather than your personal email address. I struggle with that too. Deal with it. It's okay. Keep an eye out for any new announcements or anything. Once again, once we get back to Moodle, I'll show you where that's at. There should not be any last minute changes other than we may throw out there, hey, there's a group of students that are looking to get together, March 27th to go to take a tour of the Missoula Wastewater Treatment Plant. Anybody that wants on board, you need to sign up. You may see something like that. It'll show up in the forum, and we'll send you out an email letting everybody know as well. But definitely keep up to date on this webpage and make sure you know what's going on. Let us know if you get any schedule conflicts and we'll figure it out. Click or drop and add policy is pretty straightforward, no different than any other. Academic honesty policy, unfortunately, we've been seeing a little bit of that in the past semester or two. And I'm not going to say straight out cheating, but by now you all know what plagiarism is. And that is a no-nonsense. I will say it again. That is a legal issue that we don't have any leeway on. If you're plagiarizing, that's automatic failure. There is no way around it. And it can go much higher than that. And trust me, it does. I've seen them go to the provost before. So trust me, it will get bad. Don't do it. Students with disabilities, pretty straightforward. You guys have all the information. Here's the website you can click on. Topics. This week we're just kind of doing the introduction, talking about it. We're going to talk about what biomass is, the history of it. We're going to need to get some basics down. We're going to have to take a look at thermodynamics, organic chemistry, and how plants, the chemistry of plants is kind of critical in how they work. We'll talk about the resource base, how we produce it, what are the products from it, how do we convert it into heat and power, processing it, how do we get it from the plant matter that it, that we harvest it as into chemicals and fuels. Ethanol is a biofuel. Where does it come from? Well, it comes from corn, but how did it get there? How did it get from corn to ethanol? Well, there's a chemical process to do it. We'll study that. And processing resources into natural fibers. So those are the things that we're going to, and then the environmental aspects, and then the economics of it. So we're going to take a look at all those things as kind of the breakdown of it. And it's pretty straightforward. Like I said, it's not going to be anything new. It'll be some new concepts or some new methods and techniques and ideas for you, but it's not going to be new science, not going to be new concepts. You know, we're still talking about the same laws of thermodynamics. That hasn't changed. Class flow, because it's online, the dates are actually in the Moodle shell. And I want to tell you that, oh, hey, the quiz is due on this time. I'm not sure. It's in the Moodle shell. It'll tell you what the dates are. It was set up, and this Moodle shell is pretty rigid that I don't know that we even have the ability to edit this or change this. It's on pretty serious lockdown. So whatever dates are in there, I can correct them to the year 2017, but that's about it. So whatever dates are in there, that's what we're going to roll with, okay? So don't worry about it. If you get started on it right away and it turns out that the week in Moodle starts on Monday at midnight or 0001 a.m. on Monday morning, then okay, that's just the schedule of this week. Don't get hung up on what day the classroom session is or whatever. Just go by the dates on there and you'll be fine. Let's see. To submit your work, Word, Excel, PDF, or text, I'd really prefer, my favorite two are Word or Excel, because I can work with those, I can edit those, I can do things with those. PDF or text, I can work with those as well, but I probably can't give you as good a feedback as you may want from it. If it's any other file other than those four, I can't open it. These computers don't have all the fancy whiz-bang apps that your touchpad or notebook or whatever has. We're dealing with old technology, so I need it in one of those four formats. Quizzes are worth 10 points, time limit of 35 minutes, with a bonus question thrown in. You can use whatever you want. You got the time, but you know, get yourself set down with everything ready to go. You can jump in and out of there, go to Google, whatever sources you need. But it's an individual project, right? Pretty straightforward, not doing any group quizzes. The self-directed field trip is a big deal. We've already talked about that a little bit, and then there will be a term paper based on that. And it's a fairly significant part of your grade. We'll get to that here in just a minute of how much it is. Field trip and term paper are due by the end of week 10, which is just for spring break, which means, cool, you get that knocked out, you can go on spring break and you're not stressing about a term paper, right? I don't want you spending your spring break doing a term paper, so it's due before that, get it out of the way. Let's see, and this is where, like I said, I couldn't get into the syllabus to update it. It says here most Thursdays, it's 5:26. It's not. It's at 3 o'clock. Today we're in Grizz House 9B because the parts of the heater are all over the place in Grizz House 9D. Plan on showing up at Grizz House 9 at 3 o'clock on Thursdays. And if it is not in 9D, there will be a sign on the door telling you what classroom it is in. But I'd love to see you here. And actually, I won't be seeing you here. Odds are it's going to be Brad seeing you here. But I'm sure you all want to see Brad's smiling face too. Let's see. And during that session, really in these classroom sessions, yeah, we're going to do some videos. And you know what? Next week there'll be a video just like this too. But what I like to do during these sessions, what Brad likes to do during these sessions, is this is where you come in and say, Brad, I don't understand this chemistry. I don't understand how to do this chemical equation. Brad will sit there and spend the hour and a half with you doing that chemical equation until you get it. I'm the same way. I'd rather do that because you guys don't want to hear us lecture. All right, so paper grading, pretty straightforward. Content's 40%, grammar's 30%. I am a grammar Nazi and I will be grading your paper, so stand by. If there's a little squiggly line under it, that means there's something wrong with it. I know that, you should know that as well. If you haven't yet, you will find out. All right, length, 1,500 to 2,000 words. Use your word count. That's 15%. References, need a minimum of 3. We're all big kids now. This is a 200 level class. You need at least 3 references for your paper. The discussion forums. There is a discussion forum every week talking about the topic. We're going to look at content. We're going to look at interaction, which means you can't just go on there and say, hey, what's up? That doesn't count as a forum post, right? I mean, it does at home, but it doesn't here. So you actually have to say something, put some thought into it, actually put some rational thought out there, some rational question out there, whatever. And then interaction, you need to interact with 2 other people. So respond to theirs. And make that constructive as well. I don't want to see a post of, that's a dumb idea. You may think it's a dumb idea, but expound on it and tell me why you think it's a dumb idea. And we can just avoid the whole dumb idea thing. You just say, I don't necessarily agree with you, and here's why. And give your reasons, okay? So make it constructive. So you're looking at, you need to make 3 posts a week. You need to make your own post, and then you need to interact with at least 2 other posts and give them feedback on what they put up there. I'm sure they're going to give you feedback. And then homework grading. I told you there, if you show me all your work, we can definitely work with it. So your problem's set up. If you set it up correctly, that's 3 points, no problem, 60%. Computational correctness, unlike a math class where it's either right or wrong, and at the end you either get a 1 or a 0, you know, on your test, it's only worth 40% here. I would prefer for it to be right, but worst case scenario, if you show me your work, you're getting a minimum of 60% on it. And if you're in the ballpark on your answer in your computation, we can do more about the end of that, digging into that 40% and see if we can get you at least a passing grade on it. Late assignments. Discussion forums and homework assignments. You lose 1 point a day for maximum of 2 days, after which assignment will not be accepted. For the term paper, 5 points a day for a maximum of 6 days, after which appointment the assignment will be refused. Well, if you look at the scores on these things, if it's worth 5 points and you lose a point a day, in 2 days it's no longer a passing grade, so there's no point in me grading it or you turning it in. Same with your term paper. If it's more than 6 days late, the best you can do if it's a perfect paper is 70%. If it's 7 days late, it's not a passing grade anyhow. I'm not going to waste my time grading it. Unless you have an excuse situation. If something happened, something comes up, obviously that happens. We're very lenient about that. As long as it's a realistic excuse, you know what those are. But I just didn't have you do it and not go into that area. So the grade determination overall, unit exams are 32%. That's the one test a week that you'll see on there, the 10 questions. Your discussion postings are worth 16% of your grade. Homework problems are 16% of your grade. Your field trip and your class paper are 27% of your grade, so pretty substantial. And your final exam, thankfully, is only 8% of your grade, right? So we find out how much you actually retained. There's the grade breakdown. So I tried to get in here to edit this. I can't. Obviously, today is Thursday and the 26th. So obviously these dates are off, right? I can't change them. But you know what week it is. We know if it started on the 25th. We know, and this is week 1. Just follow along. Play along. We'll see if we can't get it edited once Brad gets in, and he may be able to adjust it. So that's it for the syllabus. If you have any questions about any of that, feel free to contact me. Feel free to contact Brad. We'll do what we can to help you out. So here's the Moodle shell. Any announcements that come about will show up right up here in this little announcements thing. And We'll also send out an email. It's very easy to send a group email to everybody in the Moodle shell. So if something changes, just to make sure that you see it, that's how we will do that. There's some other presentations in here of Brad stuff. Biomax project down in Bitterroot at Bitterroot Valley Greens. It's down in Corvallis. Definitely something cool to check out. And if you guys want to do a field trip down there, I'll go down there with you and check that out again. It's pretty sweet. The Biomax trailer is a wood gasification system that they feed wood chips, wood pulp into it. They collect the gas. Through that gasification, it runs a 20 kilowatt generator to generate electricity. Right now, the goal is at a greenhouse. That's what Bitterroot Valley Greens is, with Brian Jackson is the guy in charge. Real smart dude. And they're looking at taking all their biomass, leftover byproducts from the greenhouses. They have several, well, actually they have a bunch of huge greenhouses down there. So we're talking a lot of biomass. They're going to feed it into this thing, burn it, and use the electricity generated to heat and power their greenhouses. That's the goal. It was just sitting in a parking lot over on the main campus, not doing anything but rusting. So any steps they make are a step in the right direction. He's always looking for help. And I don't mean with a pitchfork shoveling, you know, stuff. I mean with, he's looking for folks like you that have the skills to work with the computer, because obviously the thing's pretty technical and it runs on computers. He can use the computer help. He can use spreadsheet help. He can use actual mechanics help of getting in there with wrenches and working on the thing. He can use electrical help in the wiring. There's all kinds of opportunities there. If you guys are interested, by all means, check this out. Let me know. I'd be more than happy to coordinate to get you down there to check it out. As we get down here in the Moodle shell, you can see it's upside down. So we are all the way down here at the bottom in week one. And the way this is set up, there's lesson notes for each one. This is going to provide the information that is not in your book that you need to complete the week's activity. So I'm going to go through the week one just so you guys can see what it looks like. We'll click on the lesson notes. It talks about the class dynamics. This is a an online class. 16% of your grades from participation. You can read through this. You go over to the right-hand side of the page, and there's this little arrow. Click on that. Takes you to the next page. Now he's talking about the textbook. Second paragraph right there is exactly what I kind of warned you about before. Don't freak out about chapter 2. Text is meant for advanced studies at the graduate level, so it'd be like a 500, 600 level class that the textbook is good for. This is a 200 level class. We're going to treat it as such. It's not really, we won't get that heavy into the chemistry, so don't freak out when you open up the book. That third paragraph kind of tells you about it. You will not be held accountable for complex chemical equations. But there are common chemical processes that we need to be familiar with, regardless of whether we understand every little thing about them or not. We need to understand the chemical equation and how it works. So don't stress it. Like I said, just like the word problems, by the end of the semester, you'll be looking at this stuff and not even breaking a sweat. If you have any questions, Brad or I are more than happy to help you with it. Field trip and reports, 27% of your grade. Due date's 3/31, and I'm not sure, that's probably last year's. Let's see what that would look like here. That's going to be April. Well, March 31st, that looks pretty good for your due date. I'm not sure exactly what the spring break schedule is, but that's going to be pretty close.
That's last year's, because it says the week beginning on Monday, March 25th.
Right. Okay, so I'm going to guess it's going to be right around the 31st of March again this year, pre-spring break, so you can avoid that. We'll let you know for sure once we can actually get into this thing and adjust it. So keep that in mind. You basically got 2 months to get a field trip in and write a paper on it. And we'll go to the next one. Testing. I would have a calculator handy. I would have some paper handy. What I found worked really well for me was a little notebook-sized dry erase board that I just kept next to my computer. So you don't have 50 million scraps of paper floating around your chair. You can just have that one dry erase board. Kind of helps. Got 35 minutes. You got plenty of time if you know what you're doing. If you have a concern about the grades, let us know. You know, if you don't think something's right in there, as you've seen in some of the other classes, the Moodle test can be a little bit temperamental, and if you think you're pretty close on the answer, but it just didn't like your spelling or it didn't like your decimal point or something like that, let us know. We'll take a look at it. We can fix it. It's not a big deal. And like it says here, the quizzes are 10 questions, 10 points, but there are 11 questions because there's a bonus. Well, Moodle doesn't like bonuses, so if you get a perfect score, it's going to show 90.1. That just tells me you got 110% on it. Don't worry about it. We'll worry about the grading side of it. Just don't freak out if you see 90.1. That means you did awesome. You'll be able to review your test after it's graded anyhow. If there's nothing marked wrong, you got 110%. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Unit analysis. You are going to be using this every single day you work on this class, on Energy 244. So get used to it. You've been using it for a while now in Energy 101, 102. So it's really not a big deal. There is a cool link that shows you how to do this, though, right there. It's hyperlinked in here that will show you how to do that analysis. Just a couple reminders for you. Always attach units. Even in the different steps of your, as you're doing your, working your problem, label everything, because otherwise you're not going to know what that number equates to, and if you screw up, you'll never find the answer. So label everything in every single line, cancel them out just like you're supposed to, cross them out. It makes life a lot easier. Create the appropriate conversion factor to get you where you need to be, and then check your work. And the big thing on check your work is, if you think about an example, if we were going to use sawgrass to replace coal, or switchgrass to replace coal, and we think that the answer should probably be like 27 million hectares of switchgrass to replace coal, and you come up with an answer of like 237 hectares. 237 hectares is not a lot, right? That's like a pasture field in some of these ranches around here. Pretty sure that would not replace all the coal used in the world for 1 year. So think about it, use a little bit of common sense, and does that number sound like it could be realistic? That's probably the best check there is in anything. You know, if you're doing a conversion for rail cars and you come up with a answer of 25 gallons compared to a rail car, you're probably off, right? So think about that. All right, so you get done with that and you want to check that out. Now, week one introductions, I want you guys to do this, please. You can see Brad's already introduced himself on there. See Shauna on there as well, replied to it. So anybody in here, please put up a post, and this is just to introduce yourself. Yeah, I know, we already know you. Maybe something cool happened over the winter and something changed in your bio. So pop on there, say hey, say hello again if we haven't seen you in a few weeks, or introduce yourself if we have no clue who you are. That would be nice to know who we're talking to. Then there's an example problem every week, and the beauty of this is you get to see the steps. So here's your word problem up here. We want to take one quad and convert it into exajoules. So we're going to do a bunch of conversions here. We know one quad is 1 quadrillion BTUs, which is 10 to the 15th BTUs. One BTU is 1,054 joules. One exajoule is 10 to the 18th joules. We can put that into an equation. And this shows you how to do everything. This example problem will show you exactly how to do that. And there's the answer. Pretty straightforward, right? When you go to do the homework problem, and I'm not going to work it, you're not going to get quite that lucky. We're going to talk about wood slash. Wood slash has a range of heating values, but the average value is 8,000 BTUs per pound. I want to convert that number to metric units. I want to know how many megajoules per kilogram that is. Use the unit analysis and show your work. So if I do that in a Word document and I start out knowing there's 8,000 BTUs per pound, I need to convert it over to megajoules. So it's BTUs to megajoules conversion and pounds to kilograms conversion. Show me each step of that with all the labels. You'll come up with the answer, right? You guys got it. I'm not even worried about it. You guys know how to do that. And then here's the homework solution. Once the homework is done, you can click on this and it will show you whether or not you got it right. And it will show you step by step how that problem was done. And it's whether you get it right or wrong. But once you get it right or wrong, you can't go back into it. So this is not available until after you submit it.
Actually, I don't think it gets, it won't give you the answers until the due date of the submission date passes.
I think no, because I don't know that for sure, but I think that once you've submitted it, you can't go back and unsubmit it. So it'll show you regardless.
Not until it's graded.
Nope, not until it's graded? Okay. Good to know. I guess that keeps the sketchy people from passing it off to their buddy. I don't know why you would, but people do weird stuff. And then here's the quiz. And you're going to take the quiz by the end of the week. I do the homework first. I do the reading assignment. I do the lesson notes. Go through everything above that first. Do your homework. Make sure you have a good grasp on things. Then jump right into the quiz. Like I said, it's 10 questions plus a bonus question. It's not tricky. It's not meant to be hard, but there will be some calculations. So have your calculator, scratch paper ready. Make sure you got at least 35 minutes to dedicate to it. Have your Google up.
Your connection's good.
And just be ready to go. Then the lectures are going to be down here. At the bottom, right below that, they'll be in each week. And there are some old lectures from last semester in there. You can watch those. When I get this finalized, it goes to Brad. Brad will post it up on here as well. Okay, so that is all the information that we have for today. Thank you guys. Look forward to the semester and having a lot of fun with these word problems with you. And like I said, if you got any issues, please come see me, come see Brad, and we'll help you through it. We'll all struggle through it together, and it will be fun. Till then, we'll see you next week. Thanks.